everybody, and welcome to Stitching Between Pages, episode 5. I'm Robin, and you can find me on Ravelry as half past 92, and on Twitter, and still relatively newly on Instagram, as medievalisting, medievalisting, and as usual, you'll be able to find all of my contact, all of those details, and information on the patterns that I mentioned, and also the books that I mentioned, because this is both a knitting and a reading podcast, in the notes, which will be down below the video. Please, I hope you all get in touch with me, and I love hearing from people, and thank you to everybody who's been watching and who's left comments or gotten in touch with me on Ravelry, or followed me on Instagram, or, you know, whatever. It's really wonderful to be connecting with all of you, and thank you so much. So, and if you're a new viewer, if you're watching for the first time, welcome, and I hope you enjoy, and perhaps come back. I'm drinking coffee today. Again, I think this is the second time, possibly the second time in a row that I've had coffee while podcasting. I was drinking my coffee this morning, and I have a friend who is friend from college who is in town for the weekend, and she sent me a text and was like, "Do you want to get lunch?" So we went out to lunch, and I didn't finish my coffee, so I'm finishing it now. I figure it'll be good because after I podcast, I, as usual, have to go grocery shopping, and I have to clean my apartment a little bit. I was out of town last weekend. For the long holiday weekend, and I will talk more about that later. I went to Philadelphia to visit a friend and had a great time. So more to come on my trip to Philadelphia, but I'm drinking coffee, and I'm drinking it out of my Phi Beta Kappa Book Awards mug, which has the key on the other side. I was inducted into Phi Beta Kappa about a year ago when I graduated from university. And I had an internship there last fall, which was really wonderful. And as part of that, I got to attend the book awards dinner, which was a lot of fun. I haven't actually read any of the books that won the award. I own two of them, so I'm going to read them. But it's one of those things that, you know, the best intentions, I keep getting sidetracked by other things. And I will talk to you about all of the exciting books that I've been reading and some really exciting news about books. All of that to come, so stick around. I shall set my coffee aside. I also have a glass of water because it is like 85 degrees here today. It thinks it's summer already, and I guess it is. Tomorrow is June 1st. I didn't mention, I usually mention the date. Today is Sunday, May 31st, 2015. I'm not sure where the month of May went. The month of May has flown past. Tomorrow is the 1st of June, and that to me is crazy. It feels like just yesterday it was the end of March, and April was a blur, and May was a blur, and here we are, almost into June, and June is kind of summer. So, I mean, I know the summer solstice is not until the 21st of June, but June is summer. So I think I'll have to suck it up and cope with the heat and humidity that comes from living near a city that was built on a swamp. Because why wouldn't you build the new federal city on a swamp? You know. So anyways, I've lived here for how many years now, and I grew up in a city that's, or near a city that's hot and humid in the summer, and I still am not used to it. Air conditioning is a wonderful, wonderful invention, and I'll leave it at that. So anyways, let's dive straight in to the knitting. I actually don't have a whole bunch of knitting to show you this week, guys, and I don't have any good excuses. I was out of town. I did a little bit of knitting on the train to Philadelphia, and the friend that I visit is also a knitter, so I did a little bit of knitting with her, and we visited yarn shops. That is more to come on my trip and my acquisitions. But I haven't done a whole lot of knitting. I've been really busy and so it goes. But I do have some things to show you, and I'm really excited with the things that I have. So I'm going to start with my Whispering Pine shawl, which was designed by the lovely Molly of the Homespun House, of the A Homespun House podcast, which I am knitting from. I do have another skein, so I know I'm going to have to dip into that. I'm knitting this out of Swan's Island organic superwash merino sport weight. This is the lavender colorway. It's a really beautiful, I don't think my camera is doing it justice, but it's a really beautiful soft lavendery purple color. More solid. I haven't been knitting with solid colors lately, but I really love this one. It's a very, very soft color. And so let me show you the right side. I have started on the lace, and it's been a long time since I've knit lace. I've done one row of the second repeat. So there's still a lot of ways to go before I finish, but as you can tell, it's getting pretty big, and I'm really excited to see how it blocks out. But it's been a long time since I've knit any lace. Lately, I've been all about the very simple sort of textures and stripes and more relaxing knitting. So, and this and the Bonnie tank top, which I have finally printed off the chart. I did that on Friday, and I haven't had a chance to pick it up since I printed out the chart. So hopefully I'll be able to work some more on that and have some progress to show you when I podcast again in 2 weeks. But this and that have been the two lace things that I've been working on recently. And I was a little bit nervous to get back into lace. I don't know why. That's a silly thing to be nervous about, because I'm actually working from the written directions. I'm working from the chart for Bonnie, but I'm working from the written directions for Whispering Pines. And I'm not sure why. It just made more sense to me for this. So that's how it's been going. But there's no need to be nervous. It's lovely, and both those lace patterns actually are, it's very easy to predict and very easy to read from the previous row. If you've made a mistake, it's immediately obvious. Things clearly don't line up as they should, unlike some more complicated lace that I've knit where it's really hard to tell if you've made a mistake until a row or two later, or until you block it and find out that everything does not line up as it's supposed to. So I'm really enjoying this. It's lace, and it's beautiful lace too. It's really pretty, and I can see how it reflects the pine cones and pine trees that Molly had in mind when she was designing this. But it's also, happily enough, something that I can work on while I'm watching Netflix or podcasts. And I've been watching a lot of podcasts lately. I got a little bit behind on all of my regular podcast viewing, so I'm finally getting caught up on all of those, which is lovely, and it's great to have something that I can work on while I'm doing that. So like I said, the yarn is the Swan's Island organic superwash merino sport weight lavender colorway. I have three skeins. I don't expect to use all of the third skein, but there's not a whole lot left from the second skein. I clearly expect to dip into that third skein. And I'm knitting it on my HiyaHiya Sharps US 6, I believe, which is a 4 millimeter. I think that's right. I think US 6 is a 4 millimeter, 32 inch fixed circular needle. I love these needles so much. In case you hadn't gathered that from previous episodes. So that is one thing that I've been knitting on and really enjoying. This has really gotten most of my attention for the past 2 weeks in terms of knitting projects, in case you couldn't tell from how much it's grown and how many pictures I posted on Instagram of little scraps of, you know, here I am knitting it on the metro and here I am knitting it on the train to Philadelphia. So I've really been enjoying this. This is a great pattern. And I think it would be a great pattern for somebody who's looking to knit their first triangular shawl or their first shawl with a little bit of lace on it. I really like that the body, the triangular body section, has that little bit of texture to keep it interesting. I think it's picking up okay on the camera. With just the single purl stitches every now and again, it's really, it keeps it interesting a little bit. It's still very relaxing and a meditative knit, I would say. But there's something going on. It's not just mindless back and forth, which there is a time and a place for mindless back and forth stockinette. I will be the first person to admit that sometimes that's what I need. So that is one knitting project that I've been working on. And the second one is, as I mentioned this project in my last episode, at which point I had not yet begun, and I have now. It is Party Bunting by Joe Shaw, and I think I explained in my last episode that I have a colleague who's expecting her second child, and early in June we're going to have a baby shower at work for her, and so my other colleague, who is also a knitter, and I are knitting some party bunting for that baby shower, which I think is a really great idea, and I think it's really sweet, and it'll be nice to have some handmade decorations on display. And my colleague gave me a bunch of yarn that I showed off last episode, so that, you know, she knit some bunting, and they gave me the yarn, and I'm knitting some more bunting, and so it'll all be of a like color scheme. So I brought over just a few of the ones I've knit. I've knit a few more than this. But this one is a really pretty blue, and I'm going to have to ask the woman who gave me the yarn what yarn this is. It's really soft. I'm guessing it's a DK weight. What do you think? But it's really soft, and it was really lovely to knit with. And these are super simple and relaxing to knit. Can churn one out in maybe an hour tops, probably less than that. I haven't timed myself, and I'm not very good at estimating time frames. I haven't blocked any of these yet. I think I'm going to block them all at once when I'm done, so that I can measure them. And some of the yarn, this yarn, I think is more of a fingering weight, so I can block them all to be roughly the same size. I'll block the fingering weight ones a little bit more aggressively. But this one's a really pretty sage green, and like I said, I don't think we know what gender the baby is going to be, so we've obviously gone with gender neutral colors. I love yellow as a baby color. Before I started podcasting, I have a friend from high school who I knew, I didn't know her through high school. We were friends when I was in high school. She rode at the same barn where I used to ride horses. And she recently had her first baby, and she posted pictures on Facebook of the baby's nursery room, and it was yellow and gray, and I just, yellow and gray are the loveliest colors together, and I think yellow is just the sweetest color for a little baby. And I knit little booties, the Sartes booties pattern, it's the pattern that is, I think, most recognizable for baby booties. And they're just simple little booties with two crossed little Mary Jane straps. But I chose yellow and white for the booties without even knowing that my friend had chosen yellow for the baby's room, which I think is really funny. I'm glad that we still have things in common like that. And so I'm working on one in, it's kind of showing up as an orange, but it's actually a very red. Sort of a bright lipstick or bright tomato red. So I'm just a little bit into that. I started this one the other night and haven't had a chance to finish it up yet. So I'm knitting these on one of the pattern calls for, let's see here. The pattern calls for 3.5 millimeter knitting needles, which I believe is a US 4. And I wanted to knit on straights because I don't knit on my straight needles very often. I have a pretty good collection of them that actually, it sits on the top of this bookshelf in a pottery vase that my brother threw on the potter's wheel. And it was sitting in his, the vase was sitting in his room, and not really doing it, just kind of sitting on the floor. And I was like, you know, are you doing anything with that? Because that would be perfect for all of my straight knitting needles. I could have them on display. He's like, well, I don't really like it. It didn't come out how I was hoping. And I don't really like the colors and, you know, this, that, and the other. And I was like, do you mind if I take it? Because I love it. I think it's beautiful. So that's where all my straight needles live. But I don't use them very often anymore. But I don't actually have a pair of 3.5 millimeter straight knitting needles. I have, I think, a couple of pairs of US 3, which is a 3.25 millimeter, and a couple of other pairs of US 5, which is what this is, which is a 3.75 millimeter. So I just decided to go with the US 5s. It's gauge does not super matter. And the yarns are, you know, there's a few skeins that are fingering weight and a few skeins that are more of a DK or a sport or a DK. So, and it's literally just going to be hanging up at the baby shower in early June. So I wasn't too worried that it wasn't exactly what the pattern called for. And the pattern lists a gauge. I did not bother confirming that I'd gotten that gauge. I mean, I think these are the right size for bunting, you know. So anyways, my goal is to do about 10 or so, and I'm almost there. So I think I have just a couple more after I finish the red one. I can tell you what, this is the only yarn that I can tell you what it is. It's Stork by Dalgarn of Norway, which is 100% cotton. 50 gram skeins. It's about 180 meters. And this is color 12. In case anybody is curious and would like to replicate the redness of that yarn. So that is all I have in the way of things that I've been knitting. I've put about 4 or 5 rows onto my hedgerow socks. I was so obsessed with these green and cream socks, and I don't really know why they're not progressing more quickly. And I thought about it because I love the pattern. I love the yarn. I love the color. I love the cream heel. I love how they're fitting together. And it just, I'm just not inspired to pick them up. So I'm not frogging them yet. It might come to that. I might try a different pattern. So we'll see. I'm hoping that next time I podcast that I will have a whole sock to show you. That shouldn't be that hard because I only have a few more inches of the foot on that first sock to do. I've turned the heel and everything. So I'm hopeful that next time. That's 2 weeks. That's a reasonable goal, considering that I have knit a sock in less than 2 weeks. I think I can finish the foot of a sock in less than 2 weeks. But I think I was hopeful about that 2 weeks ago. So we'll see. We'll see. I have done a little teeny tiny bit of crocheting. You'll remember I showed you the Weekender. The pattern is the Weekender blanket. Which Danny of Little Bobbins Knits has been working on hers like 5 times, 10 times the size of mine. But I decided it would be fun to give a go and use up some more of my little scraps, my collection of mini skeins and leftover mini skeins from my granny square blanket. And so I think when I showed this last week, I had two hexagons that were attached to each other and a third hexagon that was not yet finished. I do have a little bit more. I'm up to, what is that? 3, 5, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we're getting there slowly, but surely. And like I said last time, this is going to be a cushion. This is not going to be a whole blanket. And it's not something that I'm in any great hurry to finish. You know, every now and again, I pick it up and do a little bit. I don't think I've done anything on it this week. I did the whatever, finished the third one and then the other four last week. So as and when, and when it is finished, when it is a cushion size, I will turn it into a cushion, and I'm okay with that. So I probably won't be showing this again for a while, you know, until it's a substantial amount bigger. But it's fun. I've gotten the hang of the hexagons a little bit better. So that is good. I can do them almost without looking at the pattern. I think I might have to look at the pattern for the next one I do because it's been a while. But when I was in the groove, I was able to do a couple without looking. So that is exciting. And then I know I said I wasn't going to show my granny square blanket every week. And I think that's true. I don't actually have the whole blanket because the only thing I've done is to crochet up some more squares. They have not been added to the blanket yet. So this square you may recognize as my second pair of New York Mystery Yarn socks, the Mystery Gray. So that will go in my blanket. And then, let's see here. These two are from Celine. And I do believe she watches. Hi, Celine. I think she watches. I hope you watch. So these two are ready to go on. And this one is still one of my favorites. It's kind of a pretty, I would call it a mushroom color. I don't know if anybody else would call it that, but that's what I would call it. And then these other three, which I worked on while I was in Philadelphia visiting my friend, are all from Marion, who lives in Germany. These two are actually from the same mini skein. And I think you can tell this color here and this color are, I don't know if they're exactly they're not exactly the same. They're more similar. But I decided to crochet up two because they're totally different. And I like them both, and I think it would be a neat sock to see how it knitted up as opposed to how it crochets up. And then this one, I really like this one. It's kind of blue, dark. It's dark. It's a dark color, but there's blue and green and, let's see here, maybe some browns and some grays and hints of like an eggplant purple color. And it's funny because when I was crocheting this square, my friend and I were watching something on Netflix in the living room of the house where she lives. And it was kind of dark. Like, I could see well enough to crochet, but it was not, we were watching something, so it was not super well lit. And I thought that this was kind of a gray color. And then I looked at it in the light the next morning, and it was not at all gray. So that was a pleasant and funny surprise. So I will add those to the blanket, which is, you know, ever an ongoing process. And I think that is all of the works in progress that I have to show. And I don't actually have any finished objects this week, so that's a little disappointing. Although I suppose that these bunting, these are technically finished, right? I've cast them off. I have not woven in the ends. And you probably, I will try to Instagram a picture and take a picture from my Ravelry project page before I take them back to work. But I don't think the baby shower is less than 2 weeks away. So by the time that I next podcast, I will have given these away. So this is as close to finished as you will see them on the podcast. Hopefully next time I podcast, the Whispering Pine shawl will be done. That's my goal. So let me move on to my acquisitions, because there are quite a few of those this week. I was pretty good and didn't buy yarn for quite some time before I went to Philadelphia because, like I said, my friend is also a knitter, and so I knew that we would be going to yarn stores, and we did. We went to two, and they were both really great. So the first one that we went to was on, okay, so I took the train up to Philadelphia. It's a couple hours on the train. And very pleasant trip. Trains are nice. The recent tragic Amtrak accident aside, I don't know if any of you saw that. I'm sure if you live in the U.S., you did. Big derailment, terrible. People were killed, and it was really awful. And it was on the same, the train was on the same route as the route that I took, although it was leaving Philadelphia, not entering Philadelphia. Leaving Philadelphia on the way to New York City. So, anyways, that aside, very pleasant two-hour trip, which is very nice length for a train journey. And so I took the train up on Saturday afternoon, left DC at about noon, got into Philadelphia a little bit after 2, and then I stayed through, I had Monday off for Memorial Day, and I took Tuesday off. So I stayed through Tuesday late afternoon was my train back to DC. So on Saturday, when I got in, dropped off my luggage, and then we went for a walk. My friend lives in Center City, Philadelphia, and prior to this trip, I'd only ever visited Philadelphia once before, very briefly, so I had very little idea of what to expect of Philadelphia as a city, and I loved it. I had no clue that Philadelphia, the Center City is tremendously walking friendly, and there's just... It's like all of those things that a city should be. There's people sitting out in the parks, and there's people at, you know, restaurants sitting at tables on the street or on the sidewalks. There's all kinds of neat shops and restaurants and dogs and people and neat buildings, neat architecture from the whole range of, you know, Philadelphia is one of the older cities in America, so it's a whole range of architectural styles. And I'm from Pittsburgh originally, so I felt like I was cheating a little bit, but I really liked Philadelphia, you guys. So we went, my friend lives in Center City on kind of near Rittenhouse Square, for anybody who's been to Philadelphia. And Rittenhouse Square is one of the 5 original public park spaces that William Penn and his surveyor set up in the 17th century. So this is an old public park. And I think I did a little bit of research on it before I podcasted because I was curious and wanted to be able to tell you guys a little bit about it. It's a beautiful park. It kind of reminds me of a little bit, maybe not, of Washington Square Park in New York City, which is another one of my favorite sort of public park spaces. You know, people go there, they take their lunch there after work or during work. People go for walks. There was a farmer's market that we walked through on Saturday. It's surrounded by, you know, beautiful buildings. Like there's a 5-star hotel, restaurants, you know, big old trees, park benches, statues, kids running around. Just a really lovely space. And it's called Rittenhouse Square. It was named after a descendant of Philadelphia's first papermaker. Don't remember what the Rittenhouse it was named for actually did, but I thought the papermaker fact was a neat one. And near Rittenhouse Square, and also near where my friend Ellen lives, there is this lovely yarn shop called Rosie's Yarn Cellar, located on Locust Street. So if any of you want to go, that's where it is. It is a cellar. It is, in fact, you have to go downstairs to get into it. Super cute little shop. Nicest guy who was working there when my friend and I went. And they have their own yarn. So of course that's what I got, because it's always fun to get yarn on trips that you can't get anywhere else, or that you can't easily get in your own city. So this is their own yarn. It's called Locust Street. And this color is so pretty. Look at how rich of a gold that is. And I think, I think my screen is doing a pretty good job of picking it up. If what I'm seeing looks like what you see, it's pretty accurate. This color is called Wissahickon, which is the name of a creek that's near Philadelphia in that kind of area of Pennsylvania that was heavily industrialized. And now there's like pretty trails and, you know, you can go for walks and things. And there's lots of bird species that live there that are native to the area, which is really cool. So the yarn itself is 75% blueface wester and 25% silk. So it's really, it's very, very soft. And the skein is 300 yards in 100 grams. I think it's probably a sport weight or so, maybe a DK weight. But yes, really excited about that. And then I also bought, because neither of my local yarn stores stock Koigu. And I have one skein that I got a while ago that I don't think I ever, I think I got it before I started podcasting. And I haven't done anything with it yet. But I really liked it. And I don't, I'd never seen or held, you know, obviously I knew about Koigu, but I'd never seen it up close. And these color, the colors are just astonishingly beautiful. I don't think this is doing it justice, but I loved this. I couldn't, oh, there we go. That's pretty good. I just couldn't leave it behind. It's kind of pinks and purples and mauves and green and blue, all in this beautiful cream background. I'm not sure yet what I'm going to do with it, because they're not the biggest of skeins, obviously. There is a pattern for a pair of little slippers. Not felted or anything, just kind of slippers that cover the top of your feet and then obviously the sole and around your heel, that is designed to use a single skein of Koigu. So I think that might be what I do with one of the two skeins that I have, but I'm not sure yet. But I couldn't leave it behind. So that was what I bought at Rosie's, again, Rosie's Yarn Cellar on Locust Street in Philadelphia. Again, lovely shop. So that was Saturday. We pretty much just went for a walk and then went out to this really cute little English pub-style restaurant called the Dandelion, which is also near Rittenhouse Square, for dinner. Delicious macaroni and cheese. I don't usually get macaroni and cheese when I go out to eat, because my mother makes the best mac and cheese and nothing can top that. But that was what I was in the mood for, and it was really good. So that was Saturday. And on Sunday, we went to church in the morning. My friend works at a church. And then just went for a long walk around the sort of historic, around Independence Hall area, which was really nice. It was a beautiful day outside, and so we decided that it would be a shame to spend it indoors. And then on Monday, which was Memorial Day here in the States, we went to the Philadelphia Museum of Art. And I love a good art museum. And I had no idea that Philadelphia had such a fabulous art museum. No idea. And it's really amazing. The collection was begun in 1876 as part of the centennial exhibition for the centennial of 1776, an independence declaration of independence. And that centennial exhibition was America's first World's Fair. And so this art museum was started then, the building that they're in now, which is this like amazing Greek revival, like full-blown columns, sculptural friezes and pediments, and painted too, the pediments, which is that kind of at the top of a Greek temple. It's that triangular. I don't know why I'm doing this interpretive dance of the building, but there's that triangular part, and there's statues inside the triangle. And now we always think about Greek and Roman statuary as white marble. And in fact, in Greek and Roman times, it was not white. They painted it. If you look up the Parthenon on the Acropolis in Athens, somebody has recreated on a computer, and it's an image, the statue of Athena that would have sat in the Parthenon. Huge statue, and it is painted in these gaudy, bright colors. To our modern eyes, it's overwhelming, actually. And that's what they've done in the pediments at the Philadelphia Museum of Art. It's pretty cool. But some of you may know, and I have never seen the Rocky movies, but that's where you would know the Museum of Art is in, I think, like three of the movies. I don't know, because I've never seen them. And I guess Rocky runs up the steps and it's famous, and we definitely saw people running up the steps and doing the Rocky pose. And so that's a thing, I guess. So some of you might know more about the Philadelphia Museum of Art because you've seen these movies and I have not. But anyways, the museum has this fabulous collection of impressionists, so Monet and lots of beautiful, beautiful Monets. I think I might have, no, I did not post any of them on Instagram. I texted my mom because she loves the impressionists. We went to there was a Monet exhibit and a Renoir exhibit when I was like 8 years old at the Art Institute in Chicago, which has another fabulous impressionist collection if you are into impressionist art, which I don't know why you wouldn't be. It's really pretty. So if you're not, I'm sorry, and you are perfectly allowed to have that opinion. But yeah, they have, it's a beautiful, beautiful collection of sort of that period of art. And they're getting ready for in June through August, I think, they're having a big Impressionist exhibit. So if you happen to be in Philadelphia during that time, I would imagine that it would be very worth checking out. From my perspective, the coolest thing was that they have an amazing pre-modern European art collection. So medieval, Renaissance, 1100 to 1500 or 1600 collection, which if you've ever been to, the closest comparison in America that I can think of is the Cloisters in New York City, which is part of the Metropolitan Museum of Art, but is not, it's a separate building. It's further, the Met is kind of near Central Park, and the Cloisters is located basically all the way, like as far north on the island of Manhattan as you can get. And when I went up there, it's green, and you look across the river, and it's green. It's very strange. I was like, are we sure I'm in New York City still? Did I fall asleep and wake up in, upstate? What happened? The Cloisters was established, I believe, in the 1920s, and I think some of the same people had a hand in collecting the art that is at the Cloisters and collecting the art that's at the Philadelphia Museum of Art, the medieval collections. Because the Cloisters has this actual, it's a medieval cloister that they took from Europe and reassembled in Manhattan. And the Philly Museum of Art is not quite on that same scale, but there are architectural installments, arches, doors, beautiful stained glass. There is a whole cloister with a fountain in the middle, and they're running water through the fountain, which I think is really lovely. It was a very meditative place to sit for a moment, rest our feet. Trying to think what else there is. There's a 15th century room that they've installed with, and they talked all about the fireplace and the wooden furnishings. There was, you know, a couple of chests and a chair and some things like that. The cooking implements that were on display, the walls, which were all paneled, and the ceiling, which is wood beams. And they didn't talk about the floor. And I was so excited because it was this beautiful tiled floor. And they didn't, the text for the exhibit did not mention the floor at all. So I was a little sad about that. But they had, the highlights for me were the Books of Hours, which are the, we tend to think now of these beautiful illuminated, they're small books that were intended for personal use, and it's hours of prayer, and they're generally centered around Mary. And they were relatively personalized. You could have whichever saints you wanted. There was a calendar of saints' days that was personalized. The art was often a little bit personalized. And, you know, they were gathered by often very wealthy households who had the money for the beautiful illuminations and the gold and the blues, which was made from lapis lazuli, so it was a very expensive color. And so they had a handful of beautiful Books of Hours on display. And then they also had a collection of reliquaries, which held the bits of saints that the relics that people prayed to and went on pilgrimages to see. And I wrote my big research project in college. My senior thesis was on relics and the Fourth Crusade. So I think relics are fascinating, the sort of way that they represent a thin place between the world of the divine and the world of the living. And the idea that if you, so there were classes of relics, and the first class relic was an actual physical body part of a saint. So the head of John the Baptist. There were three heads of John the Baptist in Constantinople at one point. The finger bone of a saint, or arms were very popular, and you often will see reliquaries, which were the boxes that were made to hold, the containers that were made to hold the relics. So you'll see a sculpted metal gem-encrusted arm. So that was a first-class relic. And there's a couple exceptions, since there were technically no first-class relics of Jesus who ascended bodily to heaven. Holy blood, up for debate. And there were some very interesting theological hoops that people jumped through to explain how the blood that Christ spilled on the cross was able to remain on earth even though he ascended. So that's a first-class relic. Second-class relic is something like a veil or a girdle or, the crown of thorns. Things that the saint touched and used during their lives. And then a third class relic is anything that has come into contact with a first or second class relic. So you could take, as a medieval pilgrim, a handkerchief with you. Touch it to the crown of thorns or relics of St. James in Santiago de Compostela, which was one of the most popular pilgrimage sites. And then you had a relic of that saint, which you could carry around with you, take it back to your hometown. And I think that's really cool. That was an accepted, you know, it made it a little bit more equal. I think scholars might debate with me on that, but that's how I see it. Very democratic moment in a religion which was not ever particularly, and is not still particularly democratic. So anyway, one more thing about the Philadelphia Museum of Art before I stop boring you all to pieces. There's five or six different buildings that, you know, you pay your admission fee and you get 2 days of admission to all of their museums. And also on Monday, we went to the Rodin Museum. Who knew that Philadelphia has the largest collection of Rodin sculptures outside of Paris, France? I didn't know that. I had no idea. No idea. And it is in this beautiful, I definitely Instagrammed a picture of the Rodin Museum for anybody who follows me. Beautiful sort of light-filled space. It's not a very big museum. It's one main gallery with a couple of galleries off to the sides and a couple of galleries off to one. It's, you know, maybe an hour would be more than sufficient to see and read everything. But it was just the most beautiful little museum, and it just did a really wonderful job of talking about Rodin and his style of sculpture, and people actually apparently accused him of taking just plaster casts and using that as his sculpture instead of, you know, sculpting, looking at something and somebody and sculpting them. They, you know, said, oh, this is too lifelike. You couldn't possibly have just sculpted it. But it did a very good job of explaining things and connecting his work to Philadelphia. It was a fabulous museum. If you are ever in Philadelphia, please go. Because it's, it was wonderful. So then on Tuesday, we went to another yarn store. And this one is called Loop. Much like Loop in London, and much like Looped in my hometown, well, DC. And they, like Rosie's Yarn Cellar, have their own, also a lovely store. These were both really great yarn stores. They also have their own yarn. It's called Loop Studio, and it is a DK weight. This is the charcoal colorway. It's very pleasant. Lighter grays, darker grays. It almost looked blue when I first picked it up. But it's not. The color is called charcoal. It is gray. It is 100% superwash merino. 350 yards to 100 grams. It's a DK weight. Let's see here. I think that is all I can tell you about it. But I got two skeins with the express intention of making the campsite shawl by Alicia Plummer, which Danny of Little Bobbins has knit two, I think, and Molly of Homespun House has knit one, and I think I remember seeing, I'm partway through her most recent episode, but I think I remember hearing that she is planning to knit a second one. And it is a pretty substantial shawl, big triangle with eyelets. And so even though I just finished my Pebble Beach, which is also eyelets, I think this is, you know, that's what this yarn is intended to be. And I think I'm going to be casting it on soon because I think it's a beautiful shawl. And I think it will work really well with this. It's not too crazy in its color transitions. It's all, you know, of the same color, just slightly different shade. So I think it'll work out really, really nicely with just the eyelet texture. And let's see here. I think that's all I have to tell you about Philadelphia. I actually made show notes, which I have never done because I wanted to make sure that I filled you in on all of the Philadelphia things that I could and had some interesting tidbits to share about the places I visited. So I think that is that for my trip to Philadelphia and my yarn acquisitions. So without further ado, I will talk about books because, let's see here, I'm trying to think if I want to start out with what I've been reading or if I want to start out with the exciting news. I think I'm going to start out with the exciting news because I did hint at it at the very beginning. And so I think filled you in on Philadelphia, so now let's talk about the exciting news, which is that Jeanette of the Bookish Stitcher podcast and I are going to be running a joint read-along. So quite a few people in the comments have said really kind things about the book section of this podcast. And I'm so glad that you all are enjoying it because I love books. I've always been a reader and I talk about books a lot. So I'm so glad that you're all enjoying it. And it would be super great if some of you would be interested in joining in. I'm going to pause in the sharing of this exciting news about this read-along to say that Pen, Hook, and Needles podcast, Marlisha and Talia. Talia very kindly mentioned my podcast, so thanks for watching. And she suggested, she was like, you need a Ravelry group. So what are your guys' thoughts on a Ravelry group? Because I can see why it would be nice, and I'd love to have that extra way to chat with you guys. But I'm not the greatest at using Ravelry forum. Like, I'm not the most active person. I belong to a handful of groups, and I post occasionally, but I'm not the most active on that aspect of the site. But for a read-along, I think it would be really great if you had, obviously, Jeanette will have a way to talk, or a chatter for our read-along. Would you guys like to see my podcast have a group for another place to chat? Let me know what you think, because I'm not sure what else I would use the group for, because I'd like to do knit-alongs and things, but I'm not in a position at the moment to, like, have exciting giveaways like so many people do, which I'm a little sad about that, but that's okay. So anyways, back to the read-along. And thank you to Talia for the shout-out and for getting in touch, and we've had some great conversation. So for this read-along with Jeanette and BookishStitcher Podcast, we are going to ask, we've picked three titles that we're both excited to read, and she is going to put up a poll in her group tomorrow, June 1st, Monday, June 1st, for you all to go vote and pick which book we read. Now, I only actually have one of the books to show you. I went to the library yesterday, and when I looked on Friday night, both the other books were checked in at the library that I go to. Got there on Saturday, and they were both checked out. So I've put them on hold, so hopefully I get them soon. And I will tell you about all three of them. But I can only show you one of them. This one is nonfiction. The other two are novels. This one is called The Girls of Atomic City, The Untold Story of the Women Who Helped Win World War II. Which was a New York Times bestseller, so hopefully it's good. And it is by, hang on, let me take the, I bought this at the National Air and Space Museum at the same time I bought the autobiography that I talked about a few episodes ago. There were really good sale prices. I got this for $10. $10 for a hardcover book. It's by Denise Kiernan. And this is about a town, Oak Ridge, Tennessee. And at the height of World War II, there were 75,000 people living in this town. So these women, many of these people were women. They came from around the South to do work. The cover blurb says, enticed by solid wages and the promise of war-ending work. Kept very much in the dark, few would ever guess the true nature of the tasks they performed each day in the hulking factories in the middle of the Appalachian Mountains. That is, until the end of the war, when Oak Ridge's secret was revealed. And so, obviously, you know, Denise spoke to many of these women who were, at the time she interviewed them, in their 80s and 90s. The book was published in 2013. So this is one option. If you are interested in nonfiction, World War II, that sort of thing, this, you should vote for this one. And like I said, both Jeanette and I are really excited about all three of these books that we've picked. So this is one. The next choice is Cat's Eye by Margaret Atwood. And again, I will list all of these titles in the little blurb thingy underneath the video. So if you miss the titles and are grabbed by one of my brief scatterbrain summaries, you can look down below and be reminded of what the book is called. So Cat's Eye is by Margaret Atwood, who is, I think, one of my favorite authors, and I think it's probably fair to say, and Jeanette, please correct me if I'm wrong, that Margaret Atwood is one of your favorite writers too. And I don't know if any of you have seen the Future Library Project, but Margaret Atwood was chosen as the first author to participate in that project, which is a project every year from 2014 to, I guess, 2113, an author will be chosen to write a work which will not be published until 2114. So this work, and there are no guidelines on what, you know, they can write anything they want. Total, complete freedom. And it's a neat project. I will post a link so that you can all go check it out. It's the concept of a Scottish artist, and they're actually growing a forest in Norway to provide paper for these books, and they are keeping a printing press, I think also in Norway, I forget exactly where, just in case publication has changed so much in the next 100 years that printing on paper books is no longer a thing that we do. So super cool project, and Margaret Atwood was the first author chosen. She just this past week, I think, deposited her book in the vault? I don't know. David Mitchell was chosen as the second author. He's author of Cloud Atlas and most recently The Bone Clocks, both of which are excellent books. I keep digressing. Goodness. So anyways, second book for the poll that your choices are is Cat's Eye by Margaret Atwood, which is about a Canadian painter. Atwood is Canadian. And she is reflecting on her childhood teenage years in Canada. So it kind of, I think, goes into Canadian history from World War I through the, you know, mid to late 20th century. So that is another option. And option number three is The Paying Guests by Sarah Waters. Sarah Waters also wrote, I've read two of Sarah Waters' other books, The Little Stranger, which is a kind of Victorian ghost mystery gothic sort of novel, and The Night Watch, which was set in World War II. And that is an interesting book. I would be interested if anybody else has read it. I'd love to talk about it because I have complicated feelings about how she structured the book, The Night Watch. It starts in like 1946 or 47, and there's a section set in that time, and then it progresses backwards, and then there's the section that's set earlier in time. And I'd be really interested to talk about it if anybody else has read it. But anyways, The Paying Guests is Sarah Waters' most recent book. It came out in 2014, so last year. And it's set in the 1920s in South London, and there is a murder mystery. So if any of you are into murder mysteries, you should go vote for that book. And so yes, that poll will go up tomorrow, Monday, June 1, on the Bookish Stitcher podcast, I think the Ravelry group. And so you can find the Ravelry group. I'll put all the details again down below. But you can find the podcast group. Bookish Stitcher is all one word, and I think it's Bookish Stitcher Podcast. But I will double check on that and put it again down below, so you'll be able to find it. So you can vote, and please go vote. Also check out Jeanette's podcast, because she's also really great. And I'm really excited for this. So we will start the read-along. There will probably be a couple of weeks to choose which book you want to read. And that will also hopefully give everybody time to get the books, investigate the books, decide that they want to read all three of them. because I know at some point I want to read all three of them. So, yes, basically, go vote in the poll, and then in a couple weeks we will announce which book, and then there will be groups to chat about it, and we'll figure it out, and I'll probably obviously talk about the book, and we'll give you a while to read it, so don't worry about that. And that would be great. And maybe by the time we decide which book, I will have a Ravelry group for my podcast, and we can all chat about it there as well as in Jeanette's Ravelry group. I don't know why I'm waving my pen around. I'm going to put it down. Okay. I've now been talking for an hour, and I do briefly want to talk about the books that I have been reading, because I like that. I like to talk about the books I've read, and I've finished a really good book, and I'm reading currently a really good book. So I finished, while I was in Philadelphia, A Wrinkle in Time by Madeline L'Engle. This is the 50th anniversary edition, which it's crazy to me that this book is, so it came out in the 60s, so it was already a well-established children's book by the time I was a child. But yes, so I was recently reminded of A Wrinkle in Time by a friend, and I have not read it since I was a kid. I read it several times when I was a kid. My mom and I read it together the first time she read it out loud to me, and it's always been one that's been dear to my heart. And to read it again now as an adult was just it was a reminder of why the childhood books that have stuck with you, they've stuck with you for a reason. And the 50th anniversary edition is really neat because it includes an introduction from, hang on, I'm gonna look this up so I don't get it wrong. An introduction from, who wrote the introduction? Catherine Patterson. I was right. Author of A Bridge to Terabithia, which is the saddest book ever. Sad book. But she wrote an introduction about her brief acquaintance with Madeline L'Engle and how this book touched her. Then there is an afterword by Madeline L'Engle's granddaughter, which I thought was really wonderful. It kind of went into Madeline L'Engle's life a little bit and why she wrote this book, and it apparently got rejected a tremendous number of times by publishers who were like, this is not an adult book because no adult would read this, but it's also not a children's book because they're not going to get the complex physics and the complex issues of spirituality and religion that go into this book. And then there is also L'Engle's Newbery Medal acceptance speech. This won the Newbery Medal in 1963. And I think those three additions really kind of reminded me why this book is so wonderful. So if you have never read A Wrinkle in Time, it's a children's book. It's a quick read. But it still resonates with me now. And yes, that's that. I don't have any more coherent thoughts because I love this book. And I think I was actually talking with, as I said, Talia from Pen, Hook, and Needles podcast. I was only coming up with her Ravelry name. That was embarrassing. She's Franciscan Gypsy on Ravelry. Talia. And we talked about rereading childhood favorite books, and she mentioned Anne of Green Gables. And I was like, oh, I haven't read Anne of Green Gables in so long. So I checked it out when I went to the library yesterday, so I'm going to read this one too. Obviously a very different book, but another wonderful childhood read. And now, very briefly, my current read is called The Fair Fight by Anna Freeman. And this book I came across on so the New York Times just put out their summer reading recommendation list. NPR, National Public Radio, just put out their summer reading recommendation list. And in response to those two reading lists, which featured overwhelmingly books by white men, Book Riot put out their own reading list, which I don't think has a single book by a white man. Lots of women, lots of authors of color. And so this one, I think it was like the third or fourth book on the list, and I was immediately was like, I have to read this. It is about it's set in the late 18th century and the early 19th century, and features lady boxers, like fighting boxers, not dogs. And I checked this out from the library yesterday, and you can see I've read almost 150 pages already. This author has done a tremendous job, Anna Freeman, has done a tremendous job of making you believe that you are in early 19th century Bristol, England. It's amazing. Like, the period detail and the way she uses language and one of the character who's the boxer, Ruth, was born in a brothel. So she is obviously of a lower class, sort of working class person. And then there's also a character, Charlotte, who was raised in sort of the aristocracy. And so far, there have been sections told from Ruth's perspective. There was a section told from the perspective of a character named George, who is friends with Charlotte's brother, school friends. And then I'm currently in a section that's told from Charlotte's perspective. And each of those characters has a very distinct voice, which is not just done through language and, in terms of like the words they use and the way they structure their sentences. But that does so much for making these characters come to life. So if you are into historical fiction or lady characters doing awesome things, this book had me at lady boxers. That was all I needed to know. If you're into any of those things, English history, whatever, so far, I highly recommend The Fair Fight by Anna Freeman. And so on that happy note, I think I am going to have to leave all of you. So have a lovely next 2 weeks. I will see you again the weekend of June 12th and 13th. And let's see here. Yeah. Have happy knitting. Happy reading. Go vote in the poll, because I'm really excited about this read-along, so that's exciting. Let us know what you want to read, because we're leaving it open to you guys. Like I said, we both want to read all three books, so check it out. Let us know. Let me know if you think this podcast should have a Ravelry group. I have one yes vote from Talia, but let me know. Thank you so much, you guys, for watching. It really means a lot to me. Every time I get an email in my inbox saying that I have a new subscriber or that somebody has commented on a video, makes me happy. It really does. I started this podcast with like absolutely no expectations. And so the fact that there are people out there who watch and who enjoy means a lot. It really means a lot to me. So yeah, happy knitting, happy reading, and I will see you in 2 weeks. Bye.